And now for the appendicular skeleton. Technically, portions of the scapula are considered part of the axial skeleton. I'm cheating a little bit, and we're going to say if part of the thing is appendicular, we're going to call it all appendicular. So apologies for that, but that's just going to clear things up a little bit. We're looking at a scapula here, and we see lots of different structures. And we're also going to have to figure out if this is right or left. Now, just to clarify, this is normally all just one bone, very, very thin, just well-loved scapula here, so the pieces break off and so on. But we do see that right here is where the humerus is going to be articulating, and we see this ridge line. This ridge line is a very thin crest, even though from this end it looks blunt. We see down here it's very thin, and so we refer to this as a scapular spine. So this is a scapular spine there, not crest, and we see the region right here is going to be the scapular notch. Then we see two portions, and I think from this view we can see one is a little bit higher up than the other. The part that's higher up that protects the front of the shoulder, right off of the scapular notch, is going to be the acromion. Acro means high, this is a higher up region, and then we see the part that comes right off the scapular spine, this is the coracoid process. I really enunciate that very well because we have coracoid and coronoid. Coracoid has two C's in there, and the scapula has a C. So coracoid belongs to the scapula itself. Now, how do we know right and left? Well, obviously, if this is going to be the scapular spine on here, this has to point dorsal. Remember that your humerus articulates right here to form the shoulder, so we can't have this facing into the body. It actually has to fit in the body this way. So if we hold it up to our own bodies, we find that this is indeed the right scapula. Even though instinctively we want to hold it up the other way and say it's left, this is your acromion process. He's going to be higher up, and he's going to be facing ventral. The coracoid is going to be more dorsal, so kind of get your orientation that way. We mentioned the humerus. Here's the humerus itself. Pretty easy to see. We have the head of the humerus, and then we have the part down here with the elbow. Now, with this part, how you know the right and left is actually very simple. We make sure that, if I kind of widen this out a little bit more, we see that our head is actually going to be facing medial, and then we look at the elbow region. Now, this little pit down here is where your elbow kind of fits in. This has to point dorsal. So actually, the humerus has to fit like this. The reason it has to point dorsally back in here with this region is for that hinge to come and for our elbows to fold forward. So we point this one medial, the head medial, and we get this pit down here for the elbow to form a joint, and this has to point dorsal, so this is going to be my left humerus. Just kind of get your orientation that way. And how this forms a joint is actually with the ulna. This fits with the pinky bone right here, and so we see that this will just snap right into that area and will fold forward. If we had this folding backward, you'd see that this bone would actually not go anywhere. The hinge itself wouldn't work. So we do have to point that facing dorsal. So if we take a look a little bit more at the ulna itself, we just see that there's a point down here. This is kind of the pinky end of the hand. We see some structures right up here. And so we get these two little lips. The high point is called the olecranon process. We see the C shape or half moon shape, so we call this the semi-lunar notch. And then we see this bottom lip to form that joint. That bottom lip is the is called the coronoid process. Now remember, the ulna itself has an N in it, and so the coronoid is right here. Don't confuse that with the coracoid that has a C, and that belongs to the scapula. The other bone on the other side, I mentioned that the ulna is on the pinky side, so we have our thumb side bone, and this is called the radius. Easy way to see that it's the radius is because we see a circle right here at the head, or the proximal end of the radius. We see a circle, half region of a circle, a half line across is called the radius, so this is the radius bone. That will lead us directly into our hand bones. Now, you will need to know, with those hand bones, we're going to need to know the individual wrist bones. I'm not going to force you to do that with the foot, but we will need to know the individual hand bones, and I've got a trick for you. So, we want to make sure we get the orientation. Now, first of all, we're looking at a hand. So, very simply, that we have, here's going to be the thumb side, so this is going to be your radius side. Here's going to be your ulna side, because this is the pinky. Now, we see that the bridge or the arch of the hand right here is called the carpals, this is the metacarpals here. The wrist bones themselves are called carpals. We have the metacarpals, and then we have the phalanges. There's one, to three phalanges, except for on the thumb, there's only one and two. Same orientation with our foot, so this is metacarpals, and then these are the carpals themselves. Now, if you take a look at our checklist, you'll see that we have scaphoid lunate, trichestrum, pisiform, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, hamate. There's a trick. I've listed these in order, and you see if, just from this that we have actually two distinct rows. We have a row that's closest to the hand, closest to the arch and fingers, and we have a part that's going to be closest to the radius and ulna. There's two rows of these things. So I've got this oriented, and it doesn't matter if we're looking at the hand either supine or prone, the pattern still falls the same. We start with the proximal row that's going to be higher up, and there's four bones, and I've labeled them from thumb to pinky. So this very first bone, we find our thumb, we find the proximal row up by the radius and ulna, and we see that the very first bone is going to be the scaphoid. The next one is called the lunate. Then we see actually two bones here, and I have to kind of cheat and lift this up a little bit. We're going to see two little bones, and those two little bones are called the trichestrum, otherwise known as the trichetrum. There's sometimes no S in there. And then the very last one is the pisiform. This is the ball of your hand. If you take a look, that's this region right here where we're going to be kind of resting our hand as we write or whatever. That's the pisiform bone. Then the very next bone we see is trapezium. I'm starting back at the thumb side, but I'm now down into the distal row. So we're going to find trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. And so really we see if we flip this hand over, so now he's supine, the exact same pattern holds true. I start at the thumb side, I still go back to the very beginning, I see scaphoid, lunate, we see the trichetrum and pisiform, and then we go back to the thumb, distal row, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. And the hamate one does have this little hook on here, so just think about hanging a slab of ham sitting right on top of that hook, and we're good to go. So those are going to be your hand hand bones as we go. And last piece, and this is going to be true for the foot as well, if we see one, two, three different finger bones, these are phalanges. Doesn't matter if you're talking fingers or toes. And remember, we're always looking at the proximal row first. So this is our proximal, middle, and distal phalange or phalanx. If we have the thumb, obviously we just have a proximal and distal one. We do not have a middle phalange with that thumb. Now, as we take a look at the leg, this will finish us up, we see the femur. Now, the femur is pretty distinctive. It is the biggest bone in the body. We see the head of the femur here with a big old neck sticking out. We see a bump up here, and on the backside, we see another one. So these are going to be very distinctive for us. They're called trochanters. They are not going to be found anywhere else in the body, so we have a greater and lesser trochanter. These are where your butt muscles or gluteal muscles are going to attach, so this is going to be on the posterior part or dorsal part of the body. This is going to be the front side or the ventral part. We have the basically the long length of the bone here. So we have the head, we kind of have the diaphysis of the femur, and then we see down here the two knobs where bone meets bone. We call those condyles. Now be careful because they do have special names. If the head is here, we follow this straight down. Well, this has got to be a medial condyle, and this has got to be the lateral condyle to form our knee. So that's the top part of our knee, the medial side and the lateral side. Now, this femur is going to articulate with the tibia. Now, in between in there is going to be nestled right in with that patellar tendon is going to be the patella itself. It is an example of a sesamoid bone that exists inside of a tendon rather than existing anywhere else in cartilage and all that. Just kind of one of those things to keep in mind. So if the tibia is like this, we got to be able to tell right and left. So if I take a look, I've got a ridge line here, and he's very sharp, but he is going to be more wedge-shaped. So he is a crest, but he does point anterior, so this is called the anterior crest. Down at the bottom of the distal end of the tibia, we will see this little shield, and I call it a shield rather than a knob because it's not a condyle. We call this a malleolus, and on the tibia, this malleolus is on the medial side. It's called the medial malleolus. So if I follow this straight up, get the anterior crest faced anteriorly, we get this medial, I know that I'm looking at the right tibia. So if this is the medial malleolus, it just stands to reason that this must be my medial condyle. That makes this on this side going to be my lateral condyle, and it'd articulate with the femur just like this. So if we see an ACL, an anterior cruciate ligament, that's going in the front, we see an LCL going on the lateral side, we see an MCL on the medial side, that's just tying this together, and we even have a PCL, a posterior cruciate ligament, that's going to go on the backside. So that's how all that fits. We went through all the structures on the tibia then, how to know right and left. We see condyles, we see the crest, we see the malleolus. The other bone on the outside of our leg is going to be the fibula. Now be careful, it's tibia and fibula. Watch your spelling from the get-go. For us all, there is a way to tell right and left from this. I'm not requiring it for class. All we need to know is that this is in fact a fibula and that this knob at the distal end then would be called a lateral malleolus. Again, it's more of a shield for the ankle bones. It's not actually a knob where bone meets bone, so we don't call it condyle. The last thing that we're going to see, and you can see that shield in place with the lateral side here and the medial side heel. Here where we have the tibia and fibula, that's going to be shielding this ankle region. Those are the malleoli as we go. And we see the foot is set up very similar to what we see with the hand. So we have the tarsals here, we have the arch of the foot here, that's going to be the metatarsals, and then we see the phalanges. I do not require that we know our tarsals, but it is one of those things that's kind of good to know. This is kind of, the heel bone itself is called the calcaneus. That really helps to get there. And then we have the talus itself that everything sits on, but the calcaneus is the heel bone. We see the metatarsals, and then we see, even though it's really tiny, we do see 1, 2, 3 different bones here found on the little pinky toe. So there are 3, even though they're not very big. We see a proximal, we see a middle, and we see a distal phalanx on each of the toes. And of course, on the great toe, the first toe, we only see 2 bones, so we see a proximal and we see a distal.